Hey, good morning, my brothers and my sisters. My brothers and my sisters, you are looking live at the Churchtown Church of God. Welcome to the little sanctuary that was dedicated in November of 1849. We found that out. We've been finding out more and more and more about our church history as we continue our journey together as a family. Good morning, Mary. I'm glad you catch this, Mary. I don't know if you're in the little group that gets tagged. I'll have to remember. I gotta remember. Create that little group. As always, if you want tagged, let me know. If you don't want tagged, let me know. I don't wanna bother anybody. That's not what we are here for. We're here to talk. I know, Rosie. And I know where you are today, Father. You know where Rosie is today, Father. Just the supernatural peace that surpasses all understanding would emanate through Rosie's life today and just give her that godly perspective on all things. How about we say that? Good morning, good morning, good. The kids take over my life, I know. You know what I might do today, Logan? I may do turning on the lights. I may do my little bit of work that I have in reserve for today. And then I may do my exercise, and then I may go get my grandkids. Because yesterday was boring. I was home with my wife all day. Oh, don't anybody tell her that. But the only reason it was kind of boring was because we were working in the house, much needed work in the house, arranging furniture, cleaning. I mean, you got to do it, right? Not every day off, even with your spouse, can be just fun and games, riding the motorcycles, running around. But it looks good. It looks good. This has been a busy little place, man. I'm telling you something else. When you're supposed to seat 100 and you're floating around 90, you've got gospel concerts. We had a nice piano recital this week. Last weekend we had movie night, then we had a gospel concert, all kind. I mean, it's just, woo! Pioneer Girls Wednesday night. Now, let me tell you, everybody, yeah, it is, right? 30% of our wall space is stained glass, if not more. And when I got here, of course, it was just single pane stained glass, untempered or untreated, no storm windows. I mean, it cost a fortune to heat this place. We got it all buttoned up. What was I saying? Look up there in the wall. Tuesday morning, the video screens are being installed. Tuesday morning, that was another thing we did this week. We had the final meeting with the professional. Shout out, Larry, I don't know if you're on here, Larry Stanger. Shout out to Alex Beitzel and A to B Pro Media. Let me get my stuff. That's why I don't have my stuff up here, because we had so many other things going on this week. I had to close up my little studio. A to B Pro Media. A, number two, letter B, Pro Media. I mean, Alex is just super. Now, we'll show you the final product next week. It's gonna be next Tuesday, right after turning on the lights. So I'm excited about that. I'm excited about a lot of things. All right, I know, you're tired of the earthquake, you're tired of all this silliness. Let me grab my Bible and we'll pray. How about that? We'll pray again. I had a nice conversation about prayer. Let's talk a little bit about prayer this morning. Let's talk a little bit about the power of God's Holy Spirit, which I'm always talking about. All right, y'all ready? Okay, here we go. You ready? Oh, you ready? Boom! I know, right? Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to be together this morning. Oh, we love you and we appreciate you. Oh, the joys of fatherhood, grandfatherhood, families. Oh, the sorrows that come with just close relationships and the turn of events that life takes, all of the joy, all of the sorrow is with us today, Lord. because this is life. And through it all, Father God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, through it all, we know that there is better yet to come. Woo! Thank you, Jesus, for who you are. Thank you for what you did. Thank you for what you do every single day, Lord. And we have absolute confidence in the promises that you have made. In Jesus' name, amen. Larry, giving a shout out to you, giving a shout out to Alex at A2B. Said we had the final. We had this place scheduled to be painted. We've had this place scheduled to be painted since October. But evidently there's no paint around. That's been a great frustration. 8 years I've been trying to get this place painted. We're finally, hire a contractor, we're getting it painted. We'll hire a contractor, we're getting it painted, no paint. So I know, I'm like, hey, Lord, it's all good. We were gonna wait for the electronic equipment till the paint was done. And there's no sign that the paint will ever be done. Unless we wanted to go get some Walmart paint, which so be it, but I would like, this paint has lasted 30 years. I'd like to get good quality stuff from a professional. So I've been having some conversations about prayer, some conversations about God's Holy Spirit. And they, of course, go hand in hand. When we look at John 15 and we look at John 16, and then we look at John 17, and we see Jesus Christ, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We see Jesus engaged in prayer. We see the community of the Trinity, and we included in that relationship through his prayer. We understand that one of the foundational aspects, I've been preaching a lot in Hebrews. I told the folks on Sunday, sometimes it's been through a fire hose, and sometimes we've gone right to a pinpoint preaching topic. But I've been, we've said, hey, it's the time to get a new contractor. God's Holy Spirit is, I will never, you will not hear me. I'm not a secessionist by any stretch of the imagination, but I am not a hyper charismatic either. I believe in the gifts of the Spirit. I believe that they are active in the church today. I believe that what I read in Scripture is true. So we see the gifts of God's Holy Spirit playing out in Scripture, in the churches, through the people. We hear them, we hear them described as causing great chaos at times and disorder. We hear them described as being a very necessary part of the body of Christ. We have to encompass, as we always talk about on here, if you want to have a very narrow view of the gifts of the Spirit or how God's Holy Spirit interacts with the individual and with the church, then you'll have a very narrow view of it. This is it. This is what I go into church expecting. This is what then happens or doesn't. But when we open up Scripture, when we hear from Christ himself about the Advocate and the purposes of the Advocate, the purposes of the Counselor, right? When we read in Hebrews about Jesus Christ as the great high priest who has entered the Holy of Holies and lives within us, and then we see how that is manifest in the churches through the Pauline epistles to the churches, and we hear about how it is taught, the good, the bad, and the ugly, about everything from the gifts of the Spirit being necessary, and it is how the body of Christ is composed, to, again, it causing for people in their own self-seeking desires, seeking this gift or that gift or wanting to do this or do that for the purposes of showing off and creating disorder. So we have it all there in Scripture, And we have to digest it all. Remember, when we talk about egalitarianism versus complementarianism, it's always versus, right? When we talk about predeterminism versus free moral agency, it's got to be versus. With the very language that we use puts us in one camp or the other. And although you know what I believe and you'll know why I believe it, because I try, and I believe that that is what God desires of us, to keep our Bibles open, to keep reading, to keep looking, to keep growing, to keep understanding. And this is no different. When we look at God's Holy Spirit and the purposes thereof, we see the good, the bad, the ugly, the glorious, the purpose, the point. We read and we know that Jesus Christ himself has prayed to the Father for the coming of God's Holy Spirit. We read in Acts 2 that this new thing that is created by the power of God's Holy Spirit. We know that the Old Testament is bridged into the New Testament, right? The new testimony is provided by God's Holy Spirit. We know that the church body is composed of individuals with gifts, everything from the gift of prophecy to the gift of administration and what's it called when you're nice to people? Hospitality. You see where I stand on that. So anyway, so you know my foundational way of approaching Scripture. It's nothing new if you are a turning on the lights follower, listener, whatever the case may be. You will know what I believe and why I believe it. And the key part is why I believe it. When I stand in that pulpit, I know the folks have every right to know what I believe and why I believe it. And then we can stand in agreement and we can be in unity, but it be in disagreement on certain points. As long as we're not in disagreement on this point, Christ lived. He died, atoning death for our sin. He rose again by the power of God, thus defeating sin and death and the fear of death. And that through his ascension, after his ascension, God sent his Holy Spirit to dwell within us and create the New Testament church. So how is that manifest? Well, I think that there are, as I've already mentioned, a couple of cautions. Because like anything else, religious or secular, we in our broken natures will crave what we want. We will seek what we desire. We will manipulate our position within the church or within our own brains to get what we think we want. It's very difficult, if you want to use that word, again, human words, but it's very challenging for a human being to be submissive to God's will. I know it is for me. And so what does that have to do with anything? Well, if I read something in here that I like and that I want and that I think I identify with, I want it. And all of a sudden, guess what? The Lord has given it to me. Are you sure? It very well may be the Lord is speaking through the Word of God, and there it is. And you're like, this, wow, okay. And in your prayer and in your submission, the Lord grants you whatever this may be. But we have to be careful, point one, that we're not seeking what we want rather than what he wants. That's point one. Now, you can use your own brains and you can think about these things that I'm about to say, and then you can look in your own mirrors and you can decide for yourself. But point one is, are we receiving what he wants? Are we the vessel that we promised we would be, or are we seeking what we want? And thus it becomes
to use biblical terminology, a self-fulfilling prophecy. Guess what? I knew it all along. I am this guy. And thus, inside my own broken selfishness, I'm thinking, and I'm so much better than you. You got it? Point two, we need to be careful as the gifts manifest themselves in worship. This is the thing. If we're looking for charismatic gifts, in particular, because the gift of discernment or the gift of hospitality is going to manifest itself in the fellowship of the family, there is absolutely no doubt about that. But as we are in the process of communal worship through music, through prayer, in the word, those sorts of things, we read in Scripture, 1 Corinthians in particular, but Ephesians, Philippians, all over the place, that these gifts, when they manifest in worship, can be very disruptive, disorderly, and serve little purpose. So again, we go back to the same premise. Are they on display because I am choosing to put them on display? Or are they on display as a congregation because we are choosing to put them on display? Or is this indeed the gifting of God's Holy Spirit? What purpose is it serving? Is it order? Is it disorder? Is it communicable and understandable? And does it edify the believer and the body of Christ? These are sincere, again, look in the mirror type of issues when we talk about the manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit in the church. Because we're taught clearly that the gifts of the Spirit as they manifest in worship, in the body of Christ, should edify the body of Christ first. What does edify mean? Strengthen, grow, deepen their understanding of God and God's word. Strengthen the individual and collectively as a body spiritually so that we may then leave this place and we leave having better than when we came, with a good understanding, knowledgeable, secure, submitted vessels, disciples of Christ. Does that make sense? Now, I'm not putting value judgments on any type of worship, any denomination, any sort of anything. I'm hopefully presenting what is here because I believe that all things are possible in God's Spirit. I believe that there are so many different denominations in large measure, if they have not been created by the selfish desires of a human being, then there are so many different denominations because there are so many different kinds of people. And we will gather with those who are more like-minded with us. It's just natural. But when we look inside Scripture, even with regard to the power and the manifestation of God's Holy Spirit, if we want to take a very narrow view, then that is what we're going to hang on to, and we're going to not deepen our faith and our understanding of what is and what can be. What can be. So that's all I'm saying. Does that make sense? We don't read that order is, or worship, our time together, worship. Not just the 20 minutes of music, people, but communal worship. From the time an individual enters the door of this kirka, this church building, and is in fellowship with the chamley, it is worship. Because we read in Acts 2:42 that fellowship is a part of worship. Prayer, singing, fellowship, and the teaching of the apostles. You're in the word, you're in prayer, you're in song, you're in fellowship. That's worship. And that is when we are all together, that's it. From start to finish and everything in between. When two or more are gathered in my name, there we are in fellowship, Acts 2:42, in worship. We are joined together as brother and sister around the world. A person from Central Africa and a person from Northern Europe could just join me in church today, wherever the case may be. And guess what? She is my sister in Christ. He is my brother in Christ. We may not even speak the same language. We may not have ever met each other before, but we are bound together by the power of God's Holy Spirit. And that is what makes fellowship a part of worship. Acts 2:42. And we learn and we grow from one another. And our love of God deepens. That's another thing. Point three. Are the gifts of the Spirit pointing toward you? These are all very related in this teaching, right? They're all just nuanced, but really everything that what I could say is, are the gifts of the Spirit manifest from your spirit or God's spirit? That could be the big umbrella statement. But that is the third point that I'm making here. Right? 3 points in a prayer this morning. Traditional sermon fodder. Are the gifts of the Spirit pointing toward God? Are the gifts of the Spirit that are manifest in you directing other people to our Savior, Jesus Christ? Or are they casting eyes upon you as a curiosity? And you like it. There may not be any way to avoid if you have a very overt, very charismatic gift of the Spirit, and it is legit, and it is, and all of those things. There may not be any way to avoid eyes being cast upon you. That may be part of the burden that you have to bear as you bear this gift that God has given you. Are you doing it on purpose? Is it your spirit or his? And when those eyes are cast upon you, are you liking it? This is the downfall of nearly every, this is one of the pitfalls of even being a shepherd. You're in front of people, you're preaching, and people are like, wow, this is really good, you're really good, you're really good, this is really good, I like this, I like this, I like you, I like you, and you're like, all of a sudden, it's me and not him. It's a pitfall of any individual who's out in front of other people. And I don't mean out in front in a competitive, I'm better than you way. Out in front, leading, shepherding, CEOs, whatever the case may be. In families, whatever. Our egos, one of the disciplines, we talked about spiritual disciplines, right? And I said intentionalities rather than disciplines. One of the way that we should be very intentional as believers and particularly as shepherds is being submitted in a prayerful state of being and understanding that whatever we do in the pulpit or as a spiritual leader, as a shepherd, in whatever capacity we are leading, from pastor to lay leader to the leader of the children's ministry, whatever the case may be, whatever we do is simply a gift of God's Holy Spirit that fits into the body of Christ. No better, no worse. The responsibilities that I have as shepherd are different, that's all, than the responsibilities that any family member has. Not better, not worse. It's not a hierarchy. Listen, this is a good way of thinking of it. Not a hierarchy, it's a structure. And as the family is accepting of my giftings and my calling to shepherd, I am accepting of their giftings and their callings. And it works very well that way. If we trust, right? Right? How many times have I said that? If we do what we're called to do and we trust that God will do what he promises to do, oh my goodness, it works out a whole lot better than if I don't trust that God will do what he promises to do and I take over. Burp! Right down the old pooper we go. Pardon my French. But you do you, this, and this is what I read. This isn't the world according to Brian. This is what we read through the Corinthians letters, through the Philippian, through Ephesians. And how we are communally as a church is discussed at length. And how God's giftings play out in the church body is discussed at length. And you can go through, you can talk about Romans, you can talk about, well, we can go and we can look at when it's good and when it's bad, what it is supposed to look like and what it is not supposed to look like. We can make, right, and primarily where we can look also after knowing all of that is in the mirror, understanding our own giftings. For him or for me. This comes down to it. This comes down to the broken nature of humankind, and however you slice it, the questions of faith come down to doing it for me, doing it for him. The preacher who stands before you professing the very power of God that raised Christ from the dead lives in you so that your will can be fulfilled on earth. You can have everything that you ever dreamt of. Speak it, name it, claim it, bind it, whatever you want to do, because it's all for you. It's all for the glory of you. Or professing the power of God that raised Christ from the dead lives in you as your advocate in this evil world, as your counselor, as you move through the grief of life, and also all of the simple challenges of life, of being a husband, wife, mother, father, moving through. The counselor, the advocate, and the one to whom we submit our wills, so that ultimately we are the vessel through which God may fulfill his will on earth as we pray. Does that make sense? And so when we can talk about the way it looks in the church, we can talk about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, we can talk about all those different things, but ultimately it comes down to our submission to God the Father through Jesus Christ the Son. And we go back then full circle to the Gospels, because that is what exactly Jesus is praying over. That is exactly what Jesus is saying and praying will happen. I am praying not only for these disciples, the immediate that are around him, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. This is Christ. This blows me away every time I read it. This is Christ then praying for me now. And so this is a thing. This was not made up by the church, so to speak. This was not made up by Paul, who writes to and about many different churches. We understand Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and understanding God's Holy Spirit is essential to who we are as disciples of Christ. He is not an it, he is the personality, he is God, he is within us. He will guide, direct, and yes, manifest himself in gifts of the Spirit. And that's what we're talking about today. But let's go on. I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. I pray that they will be one, all be one, just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you, and may they be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. If there is a wrap-up of what it means to be a Christian in a couple of sentences, there it is. We know all of the other activities of the believer. We know of all of the other activities of the church. We know all the Christianity, all the think, right, churchy things we can do, all the Christian-y things we can do. We know all the words to say, blah, 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 blah. We can give 1,001 hyper charismatic sermons and we can attract whatever the case may be. But if this isn't true, none of it's true. If this isn't true, then it is a dog and pony show. If this isn't true, then it is another concert in an auditorium. It is another faith-based this or that. But if there is not this intimate relationship, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and the devoted disciple that is you, then as we say in the modern world, all bets are off. It's not, there is a bit of a hierarchy, right? He is God and we are not. We're going to read that one more time again. If there is a better summation of what it means to be a Christian, I'm not talking about the Romans Road. I'm not talking about scriptures that may draw an individual to Christ. If there's a better description of what it means to be a state of being a Christian, a follower of Christ, a son or a daughter of the Most High God, show me, and I'm not being sarcastic, show me. I love reading these things. I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. I pray that they will all be one just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you. And may they be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me so they may be one as we are one. Are you picking up what Christ is putting down? Brothers and sisters, the power of God's Holy Spirit unifies. He creates. There I go, right? How natural is it for us to fall into that sort of language where we objectify God himself and thus use him for our own purposes? We're talking about God's Holy Spirit and his purposes to unify, his purposes to give direction and purpose, and his purposes to provide order, structure. There's nothing here about it being a free-for-all. There's nothing here. And this is where I've been misunderstood. Because, Dennis, if you're there, Dennis and I were chatting just a little bit about this heresy that is just insidiously invading mainstream Protestantism, mainstream theology. And it is the heresy of personal revelation, revelation. Now let's be very clear. You can receive personal revelation. You're not going to hear the voice of God, so saith the Lord. But you will receive, signs. You will receive a word. You will receive direction, purpose, understand. You will know it is of the Lord. But what I am talking about is the movement in Christianity today to do away with this. Less of this. Less of this. And more of this. It doesn't really matter what Scripture says, because here's what I'm hearing from God. And we hear these words all the time, all the time, all the time. What are you hearing from God? What are you hearing from God? What is God saying to you? What is God saying to you? And again, I don't want to be misunderstood. We just spoke at length about the power of God's Holy Spirit, his guidance, his purpose, his vision. That's, we seek that. We submit to that. But here's the pitfall. I hear from God directly and you don't. Be careful with that. Be careful of turning theology, the study of God, into meology. Yes, and it has in large measure, Dennis, I agree with you, it has in large measure stemmed or come out from the idea that Christianity is not channeling. It is all about your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, undoubtedly, let me not be misunderstood. You have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. But we call each other brother and sister for a reason. Because we're channeling. Because we are brothers and sisters adopted into the kingdom of God. So are you hearing me? I'm not denying. I'm saying open up the scriptures. Let's learn together what it means to be together. Let's learn together what it means to be filled by God's Holy Spirit. Let's learn together and let's grow together. Christianity is a team sport, not an individual sport. And when we go individual with it, what do we learn from Scripture on the easiest prey that Satan has? On the weakest lamb that separates him or herself from the flock. Satan is always prowling like a hungry lion. So even in our personal relationship with Jesus Christ, I don't need you. I don't need this because I got my Jesus. You got your Jesus, and you need this. It's not either or. And the foundational understanding of who God is doesn't come from me. And God saying whatever I'm claiming and that he's saying. The foundational understanding of who God is comes from this. His word. Exactly. So that is what I'm talking about. Right? And so, again, so often as human beings, we just, can we please pick just a little foxhole that we can jump in and I don't have to think about much else. You know, I don't want to keep my Bible open. I don't want to keep growing and learning and becoming. What do you mean these answers are not as simple as I want them to be? That's just our broken nature. So let's keep our Bibles open. Let's be submitted in this state of being that is prayer and supplication. Let us fulfill God's will on earth, not ours. Let's see where that goes with his church. As Hebrews teaches, let's not take that which has been made holy by the blood of Christ and treat it as something common. From our spiritual gifts to forsaking the gathering, to the idea that I receive personal revelation. So I hope all of that makes sense because you are my brothers and sisters. We are the church. And again, together. I mean, Christ died for me. There is no doubt. But he died and created this new testament. And we have his word, and we have his Holy Spirit binding us together. So it's not either or, it's both and. Do not forsake the gathering as some are wont to do. You know why? One of the large reasons why the authors of Hebrews wrote that? Is because it's not all about you. It's all about us. Yeah. You know my famous saying, Rick, you know, well, I just haven't been hearing from God. Well, read your Bible. I'm in a desert season. I'm not hearing from God. Did you burn all your Bibles? Did you lose them? I don't mean to be glib about it, but Rick's right. You know, it can be a very, very good thing when the Lord says, you know what? Go to my word. That's where you need to be right now. So God bless you guys. May he keep you. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I've heard from 1 to 3 inches and no big deal to 6 to 8 inches and absolute 50 mile per hour winds and blizzard conditions. We started out the week talking about weather. Don't know how you can have that job and get paid and still be white. I mean, good heavens. I was out there all day. Was it Monday or Tuesday? Then just cleaning up the yard, taking in the trash cans, putting everything in the garage because it's supposed to be 50 mile per hour winds. My goodness, we were out riding the motorcycle that evening. So God bless you. I hope that everything, just this old storm just goes out to sea and doesn't affect anybody. And good Lord willing, and the river don't rise. Miss Megan, oh, Rosie, your stories, I'm glad I'm not there. I am not a fan, as they say. But I do need to use up a bunch of salt. I bought a few hundred pounds of salt at the beginning of the season. Maybe I'll use up some salt. I don't have anywhere else to store it. Anyway, I got to get going. I got to go say goodbye to my lovely wife who's off to work. And you guys stay in touch. Keep commenting. Look, I know it sounds, but we've got to keep fighting this big tech stuff. I probably shouldn't even say that. I'll get flagged. But you got to interact with the video. When it comes onto YouTube, you got to like open up the YouTube video if you would, please. Like it. If you're not a part, you subscribe to the YouTube channel. It's the only way that it keeps pressing out there. Because they keep repressing it. We just have to keep doing. We got to keep doing that. And I don't want to sound like a paparazzi salesman. But that's the way it works. That's the way the algorithms work. Look, all these people are interacting with this video. Let's share it. Let's spread it around. And then they go, oh, it's a Christian stuff. Let's bring it back down. And then so we keep on doing it. So go ahead and do all that stuff. If you would please, if you don't mind. And again, I tag a bunch of people. Sometimes I forget to tag. If you don't want it, let me know. I am not going to bother you with it. I know I don't want to annoy you or jam up your newsfeed. And if you are a regular and you're not being tagged, let me know. And I will create a list because, once again, this is one thing that I know I should stop now. I said I would stop. I got to go. Facebook, you create a list of people that are tagged regularly. And it takes that away from me about every 3 months. And I have to go through everything and do it individually. So God bless you. I got to go. I love you. And it's good morning. Really good morning. Peace.